I've got another constant for you, Brady. It's Apéry's constant.
1.202569. We could go on.
What is this really? This is actually what I'm writing down here is really 1 plus 1 over 2 cubed plus 1 over 3 cubed. This sum actually appears in quantum electrodynamics. It's related to the anomalous magnetic moment of the electron, which is one of the great tests of QED. This number appears in that, so it has physical relevance, but that's not really why we're going to talk about it today. The reason I want to talk about it is because it's a crazy number in many ways, and not a lot was known about it for a very long time and is still not known about it. This goes back to 1644 when Pietro Mengele posed the Basel problem. Of course, the Basel problem was the question, was not quite this sum, but essentially this sum, 1 plus 1 over 2 squared, 1 over 3 squared, and so on. Okay, and so to get this in closed form, this was the problem, to get this in closed form. And this was famously solved by Euler in 1735, and he showed that this was equal to pi squared over 6. Now, of course, Euler being Euler, you know, wasn't going to settle for just this guy, right? He wanted to do this far more generally. So he looked at the general form of these things, 1 over 2 to the s, 1 over 3 to the s, 1 over 4 to the s, and so on, which we recognize as the Riemann zeta function. You know, one can ask what values this takes in the positive integers. And this is what Euler was interested in. And he was able to show, of course, that when you take even integers, so you look at this guy at even values, that this took the form of something rational times pi to the 2n. So of course, pi being transcendental, this guarantees that this number is also going to be transcendental, right? That was for the even positions. What about the odd? Okay, so things like zeta to the 2n plus 1, of which, of course, this guy, which is, of course, our Apéry's constant, is at the value 3. What about this? Is this rational? Is this transcendental? What is it? Euler couldn't work it out. Euler couldn't do it. And nobody knew for hundreds of years what was going on with this number until this mathematician came along, a kind of maverick mathematician, a good mathematician, but not a great mathematician, a guy called Roger Apéry actually solved this problem. And Apéry is quite an interesting character, actually. He was French, he was a very politically active. He was a prisoner of war in the Second World War. And he sort of had quite a dry sense of humour, actually. And later on, he was a member of the French resistance. At one point, he was actually stopped by the Gestapo because he was carrying an object with a long, thin object wrapped in newspaper. And the Gestapo said to him, what are you carrying there? Is it a gun? And he said, no, it's a leg. and it was a leg. It was his friend's prosthetic leg that he was going to get fixed. So he was... But, you know, this was the Gestapo he was messing with, right? So he was pushing his luck somewhat. Anyway, this sort of sense of humour, this sort of kind of maverick style actually carried through. Let's fast forward to 1978. He's coming towards the end of his career. He's a good mathematician, but not a great one. And he gives a seminar about the value of this zeta function at 3. Okay, and whether it's rational or not, which hadn't been known, which the great Euler had not been able to solve. Anyway, Apéry says he solved it, okay? It is irrational, and he can prove it. So he starts everyone's a bit skeptical, okay? So he starts his seminar, and the first thing he writes down is the following. Doesn't really matter, the details of that don't matter. The point is nobody in the audience has ever seen this formula before, okay? It's not been proven, nothing. So they immediately ask, you know, no one's seen this before, where did they find it? So where did he find this formula? And he replies, oh, they grow in my garden. So everybody's gets annoyed at this point. People start to leave. And everyone's furious. And then while this is all going on, people are leaving. Some guy at the back's got a programmable calculator and manages to verify this sum, at least the accuracy of the calculator. And then, you know, as the talk's going on, he interrupts and says and announces this. At which point everyone sits up and starts paying attention. And it turns out that Apéry has solved this hundreds of years old problem, and he proves that it is indeed irrational. And it, of course, it's fabulous. It sort of shook maths at the time. People started to try to use it to then start to ask questions about the other odd values, zeta 5, zeta 7, and so on. And they tried to use the same method, and all methods like that have so far failed, interestingly enough. So it's still not known whether those guys are rational or not.
But three we correct.
Three is definitely irrational, but it's not known whether it's transcendental. What is known about the other odd ones is that there are an infinite number of irrational ones, but we don't know which ones they are. It's even known that one of zeta 5, zeta 7, zeta 9, and zeta 11, that one of these is irrational, but we don't know which one. So it's so little known about it, and it's sort of, I think it's a fabulous number. So coming back to Apéry, I did a shout out on Twitter. I asked people to send in three randomly chosen positive integers. And the reason I did that was because I wanted to estimate Apéry's constant. Now, I'm a bit lazy, so I didn't go through all of them because I got loads. And some people put ones that are a little bit hard to manipulate as well. There's quite entertaining comments about how you can't choose that random numbers from just 140 characters and so on and so forth. But anyway, I did go through some of them. I went through quite a few. I have a list here. And what I did was I went through those numbers and I checked whether the combinations were co-prime. So in other words, I asked what was their greatest common divisor of the three numbers, and if that greatest common divisor was one, then they're co-prime. If it was some number higher than one, then they're not co-prime. So I just went through and I checked them all the different combinations. So let me do this. I've got to count this now, Brady. Because yeah, okay. I haven't actually checked this. I didn't check that the estimate came out right. So this is real time, real action stuff. So anyway, the number that are co-prime, let's just count them. Okay, so here's my list. So that's one, all the ticks are co-prime, okay?
These are all the tweeters.
These are all the tweets. Not all of them, because I there was just too many, so I had to stop at some point. But it's a lot of them, okay? So these are all the tweeters. So anyway, okay. So if they're ticked, then they're co-prime. They sent in co-prime combinations. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 41, 42. 43, 44, 48, 69, 70, 71, 72. So there's 72 of those came in as co-primes, co-prime combinations. Some people didn't send in co-prime combinations. What I've written down here are the greatest common divisors that they had. So we'll just count how many of those there were. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 14, 15. All right, did I miss any? Okay. So that's a total of, there's 87 in total, right? Okay, now I claim that this is the moment of truth now, I don't know if this is gonna work. That 87 divided by the number of so the total number divided by the co-prime number. Let's see what number this gives. Okay, that bad boy, woohoo! That's not bad, not bad. Is that good?
It's pretty close.
I think it's pretty close. I'm happy with that. I'm very happy with that estimate. Okay, good, yay. And I'm sure if I'd gone through all of them, this would have got more and more accurate, right? Okay, why? Let's suppose we had S numbers. What's the probability that any given number, so we've got some prime number P. What's the probability that any given, you pick a random number, that it's divisible by P? It's 1/P. If I've got S numbers, what's the probability that they're all divisible by P? Well, that's going to be 1/P^S. What's the probability that at least one of those S numbers is not divisible by P? That's 1 - 1/P^S. So if they now ask whether, if I've got S numbers, whether the probability that their lowest common divisor is one, basically there's no other prime numbers that they all divides them all, then I just have to take the product of this number over all the primes. So that's the product over the primes of 1 - 1/P^S. And now our friend Euler comes back, right? Because it's all Euler, you can always rely on Euler. Euler showed that the zeta function was the product over the primes, 1 - 1/P^S. To the minus 1. So this is 1/zeta^S. Okay, so this means you've got a 1 in zeta^S chance of finding a co-prime combination. Okay, so for 3, If I've got three numbers, the chances of finding a co-prime combination are 1 in zeta 3. That's why it worked. Make sense?
Thanks for watching this video. If you'd like to show a bit more support to Numberphile, you can support us on Patreon. The address there's on the screen and in the video description. That support helps us make even more and better videos. And we try to make it worth our patrons' while by adding a few extra bits and pieces for them on our Patreon page. But as always, the best support you can give us is to be subscribed to Numberphile and keep watching. We'll see you in the next video.